analysis. In our module 4, we were discussing about analysis of heat transfer problems. In today's lecture, I am going to solve problem on composite wall. Before going on to solve problems on composite wall, as I discussed in our previous lecture, we have derived the expressions for element stiffness matrix and load vectors for heat transfer due to conduction and convection. Now, one should know what mode of heat transfer is taking place from the composite wall and also what are all the formulas required to solve the problems of composite wall. In case of composite walls, the heat transfer takes place from one end to another end. What I mean to say is that if we consider a composite wall made up of two materials, the heat transfer takes place from one end to another end. And the driving force for heat transfer is temperature difference. Due to the difference in temperature, heat transfer takes place from one end to another end. Either it can take place from left end to right end or from right end to left end, depending on the temperature gradient. And one more important note to be known while solving the problems on composite wall is that whenever we solve problems on composite wall, we neglect the surface convection. The surface convection is neglected and we consider only conduction and end convection. Either it is left end convection or it is right end convection. And also we are doing one dimensional steady state analysis. Therefore, the rate of heat transfer remains constant or same, whether it might be because of convection or it might be because of conduction or it might be because of convection. Coming for the formulas, what we are going to use in the analysis of composite walls are, as I said, the composite walls are subjected to conduction mode of heat transfer and end convection mode of heat transfer. Whereas the surface convection is not at all considered for the analysis of composite wall. Therefore, the element stiffness matrix of each element in analysis of composite wall will contain conduction stiffness matrix for sure and either left end convection or right end convection depending on the boundary condition given. So therefore, coming for the formulas, one should know the element stiffness matrix of conduction and element stiffness matrix of left end convection and right end convection. Next, coming for the load vectors in the analysis of heat transfer problems, load vector due to surface convection, load vector due to heat flux, load vector due to internal heat generation, load vector due to left end convection, load vector due to right end convection. Since we are not considering the surface convection in the analysis of composite walls, we are removing the load vector due to surface convection. So therefore, one should know the formula of load vector due to internal heat generation, load vector due to heat flux, load vector due to left end convection and load vector due to right end convection. So therefore, coming for load vector, one should analyze these four load vectors. Since we are considering only conduction mode of heat transfer and end convections, one should know the cross sectional area perpendicular to the direction of heat flow. As we know that the Fourier law of heat transfer states that rate of heat transfer is directly proportional to the cross sectional area perpendicular to the direction of heat flow and the temperature gradient. So therefore, in the analysis of composite wall, it should give us the three-dimensional view of the composite wall to calculate the cross sectional area, or else it should mention the cross sectional area in the data itself. Otherwise, one should assume the cross sectional area as 1 meter square. What I mean to say is that one should give the figure in three-dimensional view, thereby one can know what is the cross sectional area in the perpendicular direction to the heat flow. If he gives the composite torque diagram like this, since the heat transfer is taking place from left end to right end, by knowing the height and width, I can calculate the cross sectional area perpendicular to the direction of heat flow. Whereas this gives us the thickness or length of element. So either you should give diagram like this, or we should mention the cross sectional area in the question itself. Otherwise, assume the cross sectional area as 1 meter square. Therefore, if I revise what we have discussed so far, the important note is that if cross sectional area is not given, then assume the cross sectional area as 1 meter square. Second important note which we have discussed is surface convection is not considered in the analysis of problems of composite wall. Moving on to the list of formulas to be known to solve problems of composite wall. Coming for element stiffness matrix, one should know the element stiffness matrix due to conduction mode of heat transfer, which is given by area of the element, thermal conductivity of the element divided by length of the element, 1, minus 1, minus 1, 1. Since we are considering only the end convection mode of heat transfer for composite walls, one should know K, H, left end convection, which is given by H end cross sectional area times 1, 0, 0, 0. Similarly, the element stiffness matrix for right end convection is given by H end cross sectional area times 0, 0, 0, 1. Moving on to the load vectors, one should know the load vector due to heat flux, which is given by F is equal to area times Q1, Q2. Very important point to be noted down is that heat added to the element is positive, heat moving out of the element is considered to be negative heat flux. Next, coming for the second load vector, that is due to internal heat generation. Load vector due to internal heat generation is given by amount of heat generated per unit volume times the area times the length divided by 2, 1, 1. Next, coming for the load vector due to left end convection, the formula for load vector due to left end convection is given by H end times the cross sectional area of the element into ambient temperature 1, 0. And the last load vector to be known is load vector due to right end convection. The formula for right end convection load vector is given by H end cross sectional area of the element times T infinity 0, 1. One should know these things before approaching or analyzing the problems on one-dimensional steady state heat transfer through composite wall because of conduction and end convection. With this knowledge, let us move on and solve our first problem of composite wall. Problem number 1 states that a composite wall consists of three different materials with thermal conductivities and thickness as shown in the figure. The outer surface is at 20 degrees Celsius and inner surface is exposed to a medium at 800 degrees Celsius. And conductivity transfer coefficient is given as 25 watt per meter square degree Celsius. Determine the temperature distribution within the wall at rate of heat transfer. The data given in the problem are, he has given the thermal conductivities of all the materials and also thickness of all the materials. Apart from that, he has mentioned that the outer surface is at a temperature of 20 degrees Celsius and inner surface is exposed to a medium at 800 degrees Celsius. That is, ambient temperature of inner surface is given, that is T infinity is equal to 800 degrees Celsius, and convective heat transfer coefficient H n is equal to 25 watt per meter square degree Celsius. The procedure to solve the one-dimensional heat transfer analysis in composite walls are similar to the procedure what we have followed for solving one-dimensional bar elements. Our step number one is finite element model. If you clearly observe the problem, I can model this problem with four nodes and three elements. So therefore, the finite element model for this problem will be four nodes and three elements. Node number 1, 2, 3 and 4, the elements are element 1, element 2 and element 3. The thickness of these elements are given. Element 1 is at a thickness of 0.3 meters. Element 2 having a thickness of 0.15 meters. And element 3 having a thickness of 0.15 meters. And element 1 is subjected to left-hand convection, whereas the temperature at node 4 is known to us, that is T4 is equal to 20 degree Celsius. As I mentioned in a previous lecture, to solve problems on composite walls or in the analysis of heat transfer problems in finite elements analysis, the governing differential equation which we have used to derive these expressions of stiffness matrix and the load vectors is a second order differential equation. So therefore, two boundary conditions are required, and he has given the two boundary conditions for us. One is convective boundary condition at node 1 and specified temperature boundary condition at node 4. The unknowns or nodal variables to be computed for this problem are T1, T2 and T3. He has given the value of T4. Moving on to step 2, that is element stiffness matrix. The element stiffness matrix for element 1, if you observe, we have left end convection and also the conduction for heat transfer for element 1. So therefore, the element stiffness matrix for element 1 will be because of conduction plus left end convection. Substituting the formula for this, formula for stiffness matrix due to conduction is given by area of the element, thermal conductivity of the element divided by length of the element, 1 minus 1 minus 1 1 plus stiffness matrix due to left end convection is given by H n into area 1 0 0 0. Now if I substitute the values and simplify, as I mentioned, if cross sectional area is not given, assume the cross sectional area as 1 meter square. He has not given us the 3D view of this composite wall, and also he has not mentioned the cross sectional area in the equation. So therefore, assume the cross sectional area as 1 meter square. So if I substitute the values, the element stiffness matrix for element 1 will become cross sectional area is 1, thermal conductivity of element 1 is known to us, which is 20 watt per meter degree Celsius, and length of element 1 is 0.3, 1 minus 1 minus 1 1 plus H n is 25, cross sectional area is unity 1 0 0 0. So if I simplify this, the element stiffness matrix for element 1 will be equal to 91.67 minus 66.67 minus 66.67 plus 66.67. Moving on to the element stiffness matrix of element 2, if you observe, the mode of heat transfer for element 2 is only because of conduction. So therefore, the element stiffness matrix of element 2 is only because of conduction. By using the formula of element stiffness matrix of conduction, it is area of the element, thermal conductivity of the element, here the length of the element 1 minus 1 minus 1 1. So substituting the values of element 2, cross section area is 1, thermal conductivity is 30, and length of the element is 0.15. So if I simplify and multiply inside the matrix, I'll get the thermal conductivity of element 2 as 200 minus 200 minus 200 and plus 200. Coming for element stiffness matrix of element 3, for element 3 also the mode of heat transfer is only because of conduction. So therefore, using the formula for conduction, substituting the corresponding values of element 3, I'll get cross section area of element 3 is 1, thermal conductivity of element 3 is 50, thickness of element 3 is 0.15, 1 minus 1 minus 1, 1. If I simplify and multiply inside the matrix, I'll get the stiffness matrix of element 3 as 333.33 minus 333.33 minus 333.33 and plus 333.33. So this completes the step 2, that is element stiffness matrix. Moving on to our step 3, that is global stiffness matrix. The assembly of global stiffness matrix is same as the procedure what we have followed for analysis of one-dimensional barometers, that is K22 of element 1 must be added to the K11 of element 2 and K11 of element 3 must be added to the K22 of element 2 and so on if the number of elements are more than 3. And the very important note to be noted down in obtaining global stiffness matrix is that the order of the global stiffness matrix is n cross n because each node has 1 degree of freedom or each node has only one variable to compute, that is temperature at each node. And also for one dimensional analysis of heat transfer problems, the global stiffness matrix is n cross n where n is number of nodes. Since this problem has 4 nodes, the order of the global stiffness matrix is 4 cross 4. Now let us determine the global stiffness matrix. If I do that, I get the global stiffness matrix will become not only values of the global stiffness matrix of element 1 first, that is 91.67 minus 66.67 minus 66.67 and plus 66.67. Now I should add K11 of element 2 to the K22 of element 1. So if I add, it will become plus 200 minus 200 minus 200 and plus 200. Now to assemble element 3 to the global stiffness matrix, I should add K11 of element 3 to the K22 of element 2. So if I do that, I will get plus 333.33 minus 333.33 minus 333.33 and plus 333.33. Fill the unfilled positions with zeros. If I simplify, I will get the global stiffness matrix for the given problem as 91.67 minus 66.67 0 0 minus 66.67 266.67 minus 200 0 0 minus 200 533.33 minus 333.33 0 0 minus 333.33 and plus 333.33. So this completes the global stiffness matrix for a given problem. Moving on to our step 4, that is load vector. As I mentioned in the beginning, beginning of this lecture, one should check for four different types of load vectors. Coming for the first one, that is heat flux. For the given problem, the flux is not at all added to the any element, and also flux is not at all moving out of any element. So therefore, there is no load vector due to heat flux. No heat flux. Coming for the second load vector to be analyzed is the internal heat generation. Neither he has given any internal heat generation of any element in the question or in the diagram. So therefore, no internal heat generation. Moving for the third load vector to be considered is the right end convection. There is no convection at the right end. No right end convection for this problem. Moving for the fourth and final load vector to be considered for analysis of heat transfer to composite wall, that is left end convection. If you observe the problem, yes, specified the left end convection. Therefore, the left end convection is specified for this problem. Whenever you are solving problems of composite walls, you should check for these four types of load vectors. This problem contains only left end convection. The formula for left end convection is known to us, that is FH due to left end is given by H end times the cross section area multiplied by T infinity 1, 0. Substituting the corresponding values, I get the load vector due to left end convection as 25 into 1 into 800 1 0. So if I simplify, I'll get the answer as load vector with left end is equal to 20,000 and 0. Now this load vector is only for element 1. For element 2 and element 3 we don't have any loads. So therefore the node number for element 1 are node number 1 and node number 2. So this is at node number 1 and this is at node number 2. Moving on to our step 5, that is global load vector. Global load vector F is equal to, at node 1 we have 20,000 watts. At node 2 there is no load. At node 3 there is no load. And at node 4 there is no load. This is at node 1, this is at node 2, this is at node 3, and this is at node 4. Only node 1 has the load of 20,000 watts. Node 3, node 4 and node 2 are not suited for any loads. Moving for our step 6, that is equilibrium equation and application of boundary condition. Equilibrium equation is given as the global surface matrix times the nodal variables which we should compute for this problem is equal to the load vector. Now the global surface matrix is known to us. If I wrote on the global surface matrix, I have 91.67, 66.67, 0, 0, this is minus, and minus 66.67, 266.67, minus 200, 0, 0, 0, minus 200, 0. Nodal variables are T1, T2, T3 and T4, whereas the load vector, global load vector F is 20,000, 0, 0 and 0. The boundary condition for this problem is T4 is equal to 20 degrees Celsius. Boundary condition is T4 is equal to 20 degrees Celsius. Now using the elimination method of finding the boundary condition, eliminate row and column corresponding to T4, that is eliminate 4th row and 4th column. Now to simplify this matrix, one should be very careful because the value of T4 is not equal to 0. Whereas in case of analysis of thousands of shafts, simply we are taking down the values and simplifying matrix which is remaining in the equilibrium equation and we computing the twists. Same is done in case of bars. If the displacement is found to be zero, that is at fixed end, the boundary condition is taken as the displacement is zero. So therefore we are only know the matrix is remaining as it is and we are solving for the displacements in case of unless of one dimension bar units. But in case of unless of heat transfer, one should be very careful because temperature will never be equal to zero. It will be having some numerical values other than 0 degrees Celsius. Therefore, if you clearly observe the matrix in row 1, this element is still active because it is eliminated only in its column. Similarly, this element is still active in second row whereas it is eliminated only in its column. Similarly, this element is still active in its row, it is eliminated only in its column. Therefore, the column which we should be get rid of in our matrix A must be multiplied with its corresponding value in the matrix B and should be taken to the right hand side. This is because of the reason the boundary condition, that is the temperature, is not equal to zero. So if I do that, I get 91.67 minus 66.67, 0 minus 66.67, 266.67 minus 200, 0 minus 200, 533.33. We multiplied with T1, T2, T3 is equal to 20,000, 0 and 0. Now, this element of row 1 should be multiplied with its corresponding term in the matrix B and taken to be right hand side. So, this will be multiplied with T4. So, since we are positive, it will become minus 0 times T4. This value will be multiplied with T4, so you will get 0 times T4. Now, coming for this term is minus 333.33. When I take it to right hand side, it will become plus 333.33 into T4. I know the value of T4, which is 20 degrees Celsius. Now, if you clearly observe, if this T4 or the boundary condition is equal to 0, then this term will be completely equal to 0. So therefore, I left out with only this matrix, that is 20,000, 0 and 0, which I got in the equilibrium equation. Since this value is not equal to 0, if you clearly observe, these two are not making any difference, but this value is making a very big impact on the answer what we are going to get. So this is the way to handle the boundary condition for analysis of heat transfer problems. And also make a note that if the displacement is specified in the analysis of one dimension bar elements, then you should handle the boundary condition in the same manner whenever you are using elimination method of handling the boundary condition. You will note on the remaining matrix and solve if and only if the boundary condition states that the known value is equal to 0. If the value is other than 0, you should follow this procedure to reduce the matrix. Now, if I solve this matrix with 3 equations with 3 unknowns using calculator, I will get the values of T1, T2, T3 as T1 is equal to 304.76 degrees Celsius, T2 is equal to 190.05 degrees Celsius, and T3 is equal to 57.14 degrees Celsius, whereas T4 is known to us, which is 20 degrees Celsius. So this is the temperature distribution within the wall which he has asked us to compute. So now he is also asking us to find the rate of heat transfer. Since we are analyzing the steady state heat transfer, whether you use the convection at the left end or use conduction for limit 1, conduction for limit 2 or conduction for limit 3, we get the same answer. So if you use conduction for element 1, the rate of heat transfer will be Q is equal to minus K A, temperature at final load minus temperature at initial load divided by length of that element. So if I substitute the values for element 1, I will get the rate of heat transfer Q as minus K for element 1 is 20, cross section area is 1, T final node for element 1 is T2, that is 190.05, minus initial node for element 1 is 1, that is 304.76, the length of element 1 is 0.3. So therefore, if I solve this equation, the rate of heat transfer for this problem will be 12.380 kilowatts, that is 12,380.67 watts. So the rate of heat transfer is same throughout the composite wall. The rate of heat transfer for the given problem is 12,380.67 watts, or is also equal to 12.38 kilowatts. If you want to verify, you can verify the answer by using convention for element 1, that is Q is also equal to Hn times the cross section area into the temperature difference. For convective mode of heat transfer, according to Newton's law of cooling, we should take the temperature difference as higher temperature minus the lower temperature. The higher temperature is T infinity, which is 800 degrees Celsius, minus T1, that is 304.76. So we should take the temperature difference as T infinity minus T1 from Newton's law of cooling for convective heat transfer at element 1 at left end. So if I substitute the values and simplify, Hn is 25, cross section area is 1, T infinity is 800 and T1 is 304.76. So which gives us 12.381 kilowatts. The answer is same. So Q is equal to 12,381 watts. So thereby I verified the rate of heat transfer remains same. This is the complete solution for the given problem, wherein which he has asked us to determine the temperature distribution within the wall and also the rate of heat transfer. The temperatures are T1 is 304.76 degrees Celsius, T2 is 190.05 degrees Celsius, T3 is 57.14 degrees Celsius, and T4 is given to us, that is 20 degrees Celsius, and the rate of heat transfer is 12.38 kilowatts. That's all for this lecture. Thank you.